Welcome everybody. My name is Luca Bruno. I work at CoreOS. I'm a CoreOS employee, and I will give a presentation on Kubernetes, but without talking about Kubernetes. Basically, our opinion on how to deploy and install and set up a Kubernetes cluster. Then it's up to you how to use it, what you do with that. There are so many ways and so many choices to make when installing a Kubernetes cluster. And we, as a company, we have some kind of like bias and opinions on what we do and what our customer needs. And this is basically just a brief overview of all of this. My name is Luca, I told you already. I'm a CoreOS engineer. I'm a software engineer and take care of OS level, so node and operating system softwares. I work in Berlin, so we have a third, so that's our third office in Europe. Sorry, that's our only office in Europe, but that's our third office. It's the smallest one. We are about 12 people there. Previously, I was here in Torino as well. I was studying here at Politecnico. And even before that, I was working as a researcher, and then after that, as an engineer, mostly around security topics. If you don't know CoreOS, that's a very brief overview. It's a company, it's a startup, it's based in San Francisco. It has been founded at the end of 2013. It was part of the Y Combinator Accelerator 2013 batch. We mostly do free software and open source. That's what everything that we do is based upon, and that's also what we write. We have three offices, as I said. The main one is San Francisco, another smaller one is in New York, and the new and smallest one is in Berlin. Our goal, our motto basically is to provide to everybody, especially to companies and people running infrastructure, some kind of self-driving or automatically operated infrastructure. So what we try to do is to provide a system which improves reliability and security, especially talking about critical updates, so applying security patches in a timely manner, in an automatic way, providing you reliability against machine failures and as well against network outages. This is basically what we run, this is what we do. This is what we define a modern infrastructure, a modern stack. Of course, like, there are so many ways of doing infrastructure and so many stacks. Our choice is first Linux as a kernel, because it's quite widespread and that's what we know the most. Then systemd as the base, so the, let's say, the framework, the user plane base for everything running on top of it. As a programming language, we typically use Go. Most of our tools and most of tools that we use that somebody else wrote, they are written in Go. Then, of course, when you start talking about distributed infrastructure, so not just one node, but a cluster, you need some kind of distributed system, distributed database, and that's where we use etcd, which is something that we wrote and which is written in Go. And then, of course, you need some way of running your application on top of this opinionated cluster, and that's where we use Docker. And this is the basis. And then on top of that, we do something else. And this something else is Kubernetes. So right before this talk, we already had another presentation about how do you use Kubernetes, what do you do with Kubernetes. So we'll not repeat again the same stuff. We just say that it's a project which has been started by Google. So internally, it was called Borg before, and it was doing more or less the same things, but slightly in a different way. And then it was open source as Kubernetes, and it has been donated to the CNCF. Yeah. This is also one of the common themes of this evening. Most of the projects that we will see, they are part of CNCF. CNCF is this foundation, part of the Linux Foundation, which takes care of grouping and maintaining and developing in a healthy manner all the components which you normally use in this kind of cloud-based infrastructure. This is a bit of a, like, Kubernetes is a bit, I place it as like an higher level compared to the other components that I showed you before, because it provides you directly primitives that you use. So for deployments, services, replicas, and everything else. So these are the things that you directly use and you directly interface with. So this is basically the system that you care about. I'm going to show you what you typically don't see or what you don't care about or you don't want to care about because it's the underlying part of it. And by the way, the current stable release of Kubernetes is 1.8. And we provide, I will show you later, some ways of automatically updating between software releases, including Kubernetes versions. And then, of course, is the big elephant in the room, which is like, yeah, how do you make money out of this open source software? That's a proper question. The answer is we sell a product, which is Protectonic, which is basically what I'm going to talk about today, minus all the marketing part, so only the technical things. It is basically a full stack based on Kubernetes and all the other technology that I just showed you before. It is focused on providing you this kind of automatically operated infrastructure. Our goal is basically to ship Kubernetes version, which is as close as possible to the vanilla one, so the upstream software that you see in the Kubernetes repository. We don't fork it, we don't maintain our own private patches or whatever. Instead, what we do is we need a bunch of add-ons and other components that we deploy on top of that. Most of them are open source as well. Some of them, the ones that are mostly related or needed to enterprises set up, they are private. But that's a very small percentage, I would say. And of course, the rest of this slide deck is very opinionated. So it's like you have multiple choices. We talked before, it was mentioned, QSpry and Cargo and kubeadmin and some other tools. They are more or less doing the same stuff. But we show some more. And I'm not saying that this is the best. I'm just saying that this is what we found so far that fits the most what we need to do. OK. So the rest of the talk is basically split in two parts. The first one, which is the one that I know the most, let's say, is what happens on a node. So you have a cluster, you have multiple machines, and those machines are running some software. And this is the first thing. So it's like seeing what are the OS components. We start with something very simple, which is you need a Linux distribution. That's what we do. We have our own Linux distribution. That was our first product, by the way. It was a bit ambiguous before. We were shipping a distribution called CoreOS as a company called CoreOS, so people were clearly confused. And so at some point, we renamed it with something which is much clearer, which is Container Linux, which is a distribution, a Linux distribution, where you run containers. It's compact. I would say minimal is not really minimal, but it's quite compact. And it doesn't ship any package manager, which means that you cannot apt-get install whatever you want on top of it. No, sorry, there are no packages, there is no package manager. Instead, it's an immutable operating system, which means that whatever we build as a distribution is a single image, which is the /user mount point, and you cannot touch that. The binary that are in there are hashed, and for every single file in there, there is a tree which is checking the integrity of those files. So it's like, sorry, you cannot touch at all the software which is inside the distribution. Instead, what you do is you run containers on top of it. Why do we do that? Because that's, I would say, the only one. Maybe there are some other ways, but that's the easiest one to achieve auto updates, which means that whenever there is some software updates, security patches, whatever, we can build it in a timely manner and ship it to you, and you can update to it in an automatic way. And we don't have to worry about, well, you have your own packages, your own stuff, which is applied on top of that. We basically just split the binaries and the configuration in different places. You take care of the configuration, and we take care of the binaries. We do that via this AB partition scheme, which is what you have in most network devices, which means you have an active partition with the binary that you're running, and a passive partition, which is where we deploy updates. And then we reboot the machine in order to boot into the new version. I mean, if something was wrong, we go back to the previous partition. On top of that, we have three stables, alpha, beta, and channel. So alpha is released quite frequently, every 2 weeks. Beta is Some of those alpha versions are, let's say, incubated a bit longer and stabilized. And so they are promoted to beta, and then every 8 weeks to stable. So most people use stable versions, stable channels everywhere. Typically, you throw in a cluster a bunch of beta and alpha machine to catch early regression or things that breaks your setup. I mentioned before we use systemd. Systemd is a very polarizing piece of software. Some people love it, some people hate it. We are on the side that we love it. We know that there are like shortcomings, drawbacks, whatever. We are not saying that it's perfect. We are just saying that it's like it really fits what we want to do. Originally, it has been developed by Red Hat. Now there are multiple contributors. The difference compared to previous init system is that you don't write your own scripts anymore. So it's like it's more or less the same story as package managers. You don't deploy your own packages on top of that. And you just write configuration files, so unit files, service files, and then systemd builds a dependency graph on top of that. Which also means that you don't script it. You interact with systemd via an interface, so a dbus interface, which is local on the machine, on the node. Then as part of systemd, there are some other projects, so it's more like an umbrella repository if you look into it. There are some other things like UDEV or NetworkD or JournalD. They are other components which are not part of the PID one, the init system, but they take care of other tasks like how to log, how to store log, how to get output from those services that I'm running, how to configure the network, how to interact with devices. So these are collectively known as the systemd repository, but in reality they are like different binary, different services, and you can choose what you want to deploy or what you don't want to deploy. These three, for example, we deploy all of them because we use all of them. Some other that are part of the repository, we don't use them. Okay, next step. Updates. I mentioned before we have this active passive AB partition scheme. Then the secret sauce on how to handle those updates is one component called update engine. This is not something that we developed initially. It's coming from the Google team, from the Chrome OS. So basically, the thing that runs on Chromebooks and on some mobile devices. It is based on a protocol called OMA, which is very simple. It's basically just HTTPS file serving. Those files are XML, and there are signal tools more or less everywhere. So on the node, you have this daemon called the update engine. The update engines just periodically poll for new updates. When there is a new update, it downloads it, it writes to the inactive, to the passive partition, and then just wait. And then you need some other component, which is something that we wrote, which is called Locksmith. And this component basically is what you directly tweak and configure to decide when you want to upgrade or apply those upgrades. Because the problem, of course, is you have a cluster of 5 nodes, and all of them are seeing that there are upgrades, so they are downloading the new software. And then they all decide to reboot at the same time, and this is midday on Monday, and this is a problem. So instead, you need some other component like Locksmith, where you can configure some policies like, well, I need most of the nodes to be up node in order to serve some applications, some traffic, so I need to define some kind of policy like at most one node at a time can update, or well, I have some maintenance windows like on Saturday evening, on Sunday morning, and just inside that maintenance windows, I want to perform upgrades. So if something goes wrong, you can manually roll back or take whatever needs to be done. And by the way, rollbacks are automatically done. So if something goes wrong with the partition, so if we do something really bad on our side, the upgrade is applied, the machine reboots, something goes wrong, and then it goes back. So here I mentioned Locksmith, which is, let's say, the first version of this configuration, upgrade configuration logic. In parentheses here, I say bare, because it's kind of like very, very basic, very simple. Instead, we are kind of like rewriting this as a different component called Cluo, which is actually deployed on top of Kubernetes, so as a deployment that you saw before, and takes care of the same configuration, but it's just another component that you deploy in your Kubernetes class. Okay. Next step, still at the OS level. You need some way to configure your machine. On, let's say on another or normal distribution, you can install Ansible, you can install Puppet, you can install other things. Here you don't have a package manager, you cannot run Python script or Perl script or Ruby script or whatever. Instead, take a different approach, which is your node, your configuration is immutable. You configure it once, you deploy the machine, and then you don't change this configuration again. If you need to change this configuration, it means that you're changing your infrastructure. If you're changing your infrastructure, you need some way to manage this stuff or to recreate the class. So basically, we have this component, which runs very early in the booting process and only on the first boot. It takes care of provisioning the machine. So it's like configuring services or partitioning disk, assembling RAIDs, or mounting volumes, or whatever. You supply the input here as user data. So for example, if you're used to AWS, where you specify the machine user data, this is what Ignition takes. And inside this file, which is a JSON file, you mention how this machine must be configured. This component takes a JSON input, which is not the most easily thing to write. So instead, if you prefer YAML, which is a bit more human readable, there is also Transpiler, which takes YAML, applies some magic sauce, writes the JSON input. Okay. There are a few more components at the US level. One is called Torx. It's very recent, and it solves another issue, which is, well, now I have these components which are changing all the time. I have some specific needs, like I need to run a Docker version X, which is not yet available in this channel, or it's not anymore available in this channel. So what Torx does, it lets you manage add-ons on top of container Linux. The distribution is still immutable, but you can, but there's some kind of like room for changing and adding stuff on top of that. But all those changes are ephemeral. It means that they are applied when the machine is booting, every boots, and then when you are rebooting, they just disappear. Okay, now we're moving upper in the layers. We are reaching the point where you actually need to run your application. Whether you run your application, you don't have a package manager or something similar, an interpreter or compiler or whatever. Well, you package it, you ship it in a container registry, and then run it in Docker. That's the single stop solution for anything containerized. It has kind of like, an opinionated in design architecture. So it is a centralized solution. You have this Docker daemon which does everything, and then you interact with it with the Docker client. And you have this daemon always there. It's very easy to use. It's basically hiding all the complexity of C groups and namespaces, and for you it just, well, I have my container and I'm running it. Which is fine most of the time, except when it isn't. And we actually had that problem. The problem mostly was, well, you have this daemon, and if it crashes, or if it locks, or if there are some other issues, it's very hard to recover from that. On top of that, well, we have another supervisor, which is the systemd stuff, which is running on our machines, and is already taking care of managing and supervising services. But in this case, it cannot, because it's a single daemon, and you cannot manage in a different ways container inside a single daemon. So instead, we came up with a different, again, opinionated container runtime, which is called Rocket. By the way, I'm the tech lead of Rocket, so if you have technical questions, just ask again. We did write Rocket just because, well, we don't like Docker. We wrote Rocket because, well, we have some use cases, some peculiar use cases, where Docker is not enough or is not the best thing. So instead, Rocket doesn't have a daemon, a central daemon. Every container that you run is a different process tree. So you can kill them in a separate way, you can manage them in a separate way, which means that you can natively integrate them with systemd. Every service basically is its own process tree and a Rocket container execution. It also adds some other things on top of that, like, well, we have pods as well as first class citizens, so you can mix multiple containers inside the same pod, and again, they are a single a single service from the point of view of the supervisor or systemd. And then again, when we did this, there was still not a lot of open specification efforts. So the CNCF Foundation was still not existing or very young, and most of the things were rapidly changing, which means that, well, you don't have a clear specification or something that is guaranteed not to change and to keep working the same way. So instead, we brought Rocket Base. So first, we wrote the specification for what we want to actually run, and then we wrote the software which takes care of being compliant with the specification. So we have our own images, which are conforming to another open spec, which is called AppC. And then we do networking in a kind of different way with this CNI, which means Container Network Interface spec. And that's the core of it. It's just a different container runtime, which is based on modularity and decentralization. Okay. Now we finished the OS overview. We're moving into Kubernetes world. We start from how do you actually deploy and set up your Kubernetes cluster? Well, there are multiple ways again. I'm not saying that this is better than Cargo or Kubespace for me. It's just that this is what most of our customers are already using. So already have Terraform, which is one software which lets you write infrastructure as a code. So the configuration is inside Git, and it is a declarative description of what your infrastructure looks like. And then it takes care of setting up via Cloud API all the infrastructure, and as well it takes care of configuring the node. Again, via ignition. I will show the software. I will show the configuration of the software for this later. But I will just say that this, well, it's modular, so you can write your own plugins and your own modules. And this is exactly what we do. Then again, when a node is joining a Kubernetes cluster, basically the only things that you need to know is that, well, there is a node agent, a Kubernetes node agent, which is running on this machine. This node agent is called the kubelet. The kubelet is deployed at least on CoreOS is deployed as a systemd service inside a Rocket container. So that's where previous tools are coming into place. Execution, so kubelet doesn't directly execute your container. Instead, it uses Docker or something else to execute them. There is an interface between these two components called the CRI, the container runtime interface, which is based on gRPC. And actually, if you want, there are other, let's say, alternative slash experimental runtimes, like you can run Kubernetes on top of Rocket, or on top of directly Containerd, or on top of Creo. So there are multiple alternatives there. Docker is the default one, and it's the most complete one. So that's what basically everybody has in production. Then now we steps a bit farther from the node and infrastructure. We take a look at how do you actually synchronize the tape, how do you take care of the distributed side of this system. Here we have etcd, which is a distributed key value store, which means that, well, it's a database, it runs on multiple nodes, so it's a cluster, and you write keys to it, and those keys, they contain a value. And then etcd guarantees that whatever you write and read from this database is consistent. Consistent as in cap tier. Cap tiering is one way of saying, well, whenever you write a database, you have three properties. One is consistency, the other is availability, and the other is network partition tolerance. So those are three properties, and you can get at most two of them. In the real world, you cannot get rid of the partition tolerance, because it's like, well, you cannot guarantee that your network is always completely working 100% of the time. So you basically take care of deciding. I want my system to be consistent, which means, well, if something goes wrong, I may not be able to write and read to it, or you decide that your system is available, which means, well, if something goes wrong, I write to it, and then, well, I can get different results if I'm writing to one node on one side of the split, of the network split, or to another node on the other side of the network split. Etcd is on the consistency side. It's currently at version 3. It is used inside Kubernetes as the distributed database. Actually, it exposes a gRPC interface, same as the other kubelet one. which is basically just some HTTP2, which is serving some Rotolf endpoints. And again, here it's etcd in a CoreOS Kubernetes cluster is deployed as systemd plus Rotolf. Next topic is networking. Again, you have multiple ways of setting up your network and taking care of that. What we did here is, well, we don't want to put together the container execution and the network setup and everything else like it was in Docker before. Instead, we have specification and plugins to take care of that, and they only take care of the networking part. And then the container runtimes take care of executing the container, and something gets on top of that bridges between the two. So this standard interface is called CNI. Again, it's another component inside the CNCF foundation. So this big umbrella foundation is basically collecting all of them. Originally, it has been developed inside Rocket. Again, because we were writing a container runtime and we were trying to avoid implementing everything inside of it. It's a plugin system, so basically you write your own stuff if you have some special needs. Otherwise, you use the core plugins, which are provided as part of CNI. And basically, you just describe a chain of, well, my networks, the networking part for my pods needs to be done in this way. It has a virtual Ethernet interface, and this virtual Ethernet interface on one side, it has a host gateway. On the other side, it has some restricted subnet for the container, and that's just it. Then, of course, well, we had a specification and we started implementing whatever we need on the network side. What you need on the network side in a Kubernetes cluster typically is some way of letting pods in different machines talk to each other. Because if you are deploying on AWS or on some other cloud machine, you may have multiple VPC, multiple zones, multiple regions, and those are not directly connected, not directly reachable. Or you can have like multiple clouds provided multiple infrastructures and they don't have any way to talk to each other. So instead, we set up what is called an overlay network, which means a flat network which is just available to pods. And we do that via Flannel, which is something that we originally wrote and then now somebody else is taking care of it, which is basically just providing a virtual interface for your pod internally, and then externally it is encapsulating all the traffic on VXLAN, which is some layer 2 encapsulation. So basically, traffic leaves the pod doesn't know about the networking except that there is a flat network. And then when it is leaving the node, the host, it gets this kind of VXLAN encapsulation, and then when it goes to the other node, this is decapsulated and forwarded to another pod. There is a problem with this, which is, well, now you have all these pods and they are doing different things, and some of them are like kind of critical, some of them are user-facing, some of them are internal only, and there is no segmentation between them. This is by design, let's say, it's what why you have an overlay network. On top of that, you deploy some kind of policy. So the policies just say, well, I want to segment this flat network according to these rules. And in order to do that, we use Calico, which is a product by Taigera, which takes care of exactly of this kind of segmentation. It's compatible with CNI, so you just define another chain configuration in this system. And it has a lot of configuration of what you actually want to do, how to configure it, depending on what is your network setup. What we deploy, what we have typically seen in production is, well, either you're already running Flannel, so you just want to segregate this kind of overlay network, or you don't have an overlay network because you are kind of lucky and you manage all your infrastructure, including the network part. So you can just use plain routing. And then in that case, well, you maybe already have some kind of routing system inside your network. You can already speak BGP. And so, well, there is a plugin which does exactly that. It just configures IP tables and routing based on BGP. I'm almost at the end of this. Now we are getting into like higher level topics. Well, I have a cluster, it's working, it runs Docker plus the orchestrator for Kubernetes, can do a lot of wonderful stuff. I can set up the network as I want. I have no visibility on what's going on, and this is a very complex system. So it's like so many things can go wrong, or I may not need about some, I may not know about some details. So again, here we made a choice. There are again multiple monitoring solutions. We made a choice, which is Prometheus, which again is coming out of an idea from Google. What it used to be the monitoring part for Borg, Borgman. Prometheus is a scalable system for storing time series, so a set of events at some point in time. And then it has a component which is, sits on top of that, which based on some logic can send you alert like, well, there is too high utilization of this specific CPU, so please alert me. Contrarily to most of the other monitoring system, it's poll based, which means Prometheus is not just sitting there and waiting for events to be sent to him, to it. Instead, it is actively polling all the targets and just retrieving the metrics from them. This is because, well, it needs to scale, because if you have pods and container and microservice architecture, you may have a large number of them. And if all of them are sending traffic to a single node, to a single instance, it will probably like overload it. And again, here, another thing is, this one as well is based on protobuf and HTTP. Nothing fancy. That's the source of most of the components in a cloud, in a Kubernetes infrastructure. Last two components, those are very like higher level. We recently come up with another idea for a problem that we had. The problem is, well, you have all these components that now are running on top of a Kubernetes cluster, which are part of the Kubernetes cluster, but we have no way of deploying them, configuring them, auto-updating them, because, well, there is a new Kubernetes release every month, every couple of months, I don't remember the release cycle. And as we do for the operating system, we want to auto-update those clusters as well. So you are not stuck with Kubernetes 1.0 forever, but the cluster is evolving as well as the distribution. So what we do is we start writing this class of software, and then we realize that it's a class of software. We wrote multiple of them, and then we realize they are basically all doing the same things, which is managing some other software in a smart way. The smart way is basically the operational knowledge that we need. So we know how Prometheus works, how it must be deployed. We know how etcd works, how it must be deployed, and so on and so far. We just need some other component which is taking care of actually deploying and configuring them. So we started writing operators. Initially, we wrote three, one for etcd, one for container Linux, and the other from Prometheus. And then other companies realized that, well, they have more or less the same problem, the same issue, and they could solve it in the same way. So they started writing their own operators for deploying other services like Vault for secret storage, Rook for the storage for the volumes, Habitat for other kinds of system level services, and more. So we just give a very stupid example, which is something that I mentioned at the start. We initially had this Locksmith, which was taking care of managing upgrades on every single node, but this was not aware of Kubernetes. So he didn't know that there was a Kubernetes cluster, he just knew that there are multiple container Linux nodes and they must synchronize in some way. It's kind of silly if you think about that we basically need to re-implement a full cluster orchestration solution inside of Locksmith to take care of this. Distributed reboots, distributed upgrades. So what we did recently, what we are still doing, is moving this component into a Kubernetes component. So moving it one layer up. Locksmith now is called CLUO, Container Linux Update Operator, and it takes care of exactly the same things. It's just a component which is deployed on top of Kubernetes and is aware of the whole Kubernetes cluster and manages updates across it. And there are, of course, two components. One is on the node, and which is what is actually sending the signal in order to reboot. And the other one is in the cluster, and this is the one that you directly configure to say, well, my cluster, the allowed maintenance windows is exactly this time, and I want a maximum of these nodes to be rebooted at the same time. And that's it. And then there are some other details, like, well, you can put hooks in order to run things before rebooting or after rebooting in order to run custom version. And that's it. It was a bit long. So I will do a very brief demo. While I was speaking, I was also bootstrapping a cluster of three nodes locally on this laptop, which is here, which is good. it came up. So this is our Tectonic dashboard, which is basically a glorified Kubernetes dashboard, which integrates all the other components I showed you before. Before going to here, I will just show you. Well, this is our answer to how do we deploy a Kubernetes solution, a Tectonic solution, which is our Tectonic installer. It is completely based on Terraform, which means that, well, we write for you a bunch of software modules that they take care of, I don't know, ignition configuration. Ah, you cannot see at all, sorry. you take care of ignition configuration or network configuration or TLS configuration or some other like bootstrapping the Kubernetes cluster or what else. And then we write a bunch of platform modules, so you can apply the same logic on different platforms, Azure, AWS, OpenStack, or what else. And then what you do is you have a single. Let's see what I have it. You have a single. Can you see something? Yeah, you can see something more or less. Okay. You have a single configuration file. This. Okay, sorry, I don't have six syntax highlighting. What you basically define? Well, my cluster is made of three nodes, two of them are workers, another is a master, or any configuration, any combination that you think about. This is the DNS based domain for it. This is how you reach it. In this case, it's like, it's very bare, because it's a bare metal cluster. So like, this is equivalent of a Pixie-based infrastructure where you don't have any cloud API, you do everything from scratch. There are some other different configuration options for, I want to have an AWS VPC, or an AWS S3 bucket, or an AWS what else, whatever you may want to configure. And this is how you configure it. This is how you install the cluster. And the result is, what I want to show you is, because I have bad memory, so I don't remember what I wanted to show you. Okay, so let me see. For example, I mentioned before, how do we run the kubelet? Well, the kubelet is a systemd service unit. If you have never seen a systemd service unit, this is a systemd service unit. And then we just run some container inside of Rocket. These are the arguments that we pass to Rocket. And in this file, and again, we try to apply the same logic everywhere. Like, yeah, you keep your user configuration on one side and our distribution and installer logic in some other place. So in some other file, in this environment file, you specify, well, my kubelet is actually a container which is stored on Quay, and it is exactly this version. So this is a 1.7.6 cluster, for example. Same for, let me see. Same for etcd. Oops, sorry. Same for etcd. Again, it's another Rocket container, and the same applies as before. And then we do some custom configuration, like the installer is taking care on your behalf of provisioning all the TLS configuration so that you have in place a CA, a server certificate, and then you know which client certificate are trusted and whatnot. And then you know which nodes are part of the cluster and what is actually the advertised URL for this specific node and so on and so forth. Okay, what else I can show you here? Let me see. And then again, by doing this, you basically just benefit from all the other components that I showed you before. So the question now could be like, well, I want to see logs from etcd. Sure, they are inside the Rocket container, and this Rocket container is integrated with systemd, which means that you get it directly via systemd journal d, and that's exactly what it is. And if you want to see other logs as well, it's the same as before. They are just all of them inside journal lien, and this is the tail of it. This is all the logging stuff taken care of in a single place. This is at a node level. Let's go into a cluster level detail. Well, my cluster is just a Kubernetes cluster, so I have three nodes inside of it. Not one, not two, not three, not example. Then if you want to see something, let's see. It's a bit too much zoomed in, so not great to see, but well, it's a single node, it is running some pods, and then you get information about that. And on top of it, you have some other things like, well, this node doesn't have any problems, so it's not out of disk, it doesn't have memory pressure issues or disk pressure issues or whatever, it's ready. And there are some other annotations that you put on top of it, like, well, this node is actually a master node as opposed to a worker node. It is running this specific version. And we actually check if there are new version at this time. This is the node level part of the logic. And then there is this other component, the Clue operator inside the cluster, which is taking care of making the decision in a wide and holistic way. Okay, let's say that, well, now I look into the cluster. Of course, there are other ways of showing the same that I show you here, so you don't need a graphical interface for that, a web interface for that. But basically what you do is we deploy a bunch of things. Let me switch to this view. So this is the default space. This is what you would use for your application, and you see it's completely empty. Then there is a kube system namespace, which is what you get in a typical, let's say, vanilla cluster, which is a Kubernetes deployment. The components of Kubernetes are actually running inside Kubernetes itself. So if you start killing one of those pods, they will respawn. They will be respawned automatically by the Kubernetes scheduler, by the schedule manager. And then the last part of it is what we apply on top of it. It's basically split in two, let's say, categories. The first one is which kind of additional components you may want to have in this cluster, like some Grafana to visualize things, or Prometheus to monitor it, or the Clue operator in order to take care of updates. This same console, which is self-hosted, the identity, so the OIDC identity service. And then you have the last category, which is operators. Operators are mostly like inactive most of the time. They are just reacting to events, like there is a new version of Tectonic available. Cool. Let's download all the components and start rolling it out. And then they also take care of the initial part, which is, well, now I have this very nice infrastructure. I want to deploy Kubernetes with some other components on top of that, which was the previous question. How do I do it? By deploying some software first, which takes care of the rest of it, and which is also able to automatically update those other components. Okay, I think that's it, because I'm mostly out of time. So thanks for following along, and questions? In Italian, if you